My name is Heather Ramsbottom, and I work at PI, and I've been around for quite some time working with PI, and for one thing that's important to let people know, if they're not familiar with who I am, is that you often want people who are teaching about nutrition, coaching about nutrition, to practice what they preach, and to look the part. If you're wondering why I'm sporting this belly, I'm halfway through my pregnancy, so this is not from too many cookies, this is a healthy dog here. So, without further ado, let me just talk really quickly about what we're going to go over today. And this is basically a new method of sports nutrition. I'm going to quickly review what the old school or more traditional approach to sports nutrition is. And there's still some merits and value in that approach, but I really think they've made some great improvements with this new approach. I'm going to talk about the advantages and disadvantage of the traditional approach versus this new approach, and as well, near the end, we're going to talk about if you are an athlete or even just a healthy, active person in general, what happens if you sustain an acute injury and how can you use a little bit of nutrition knowledge to help you recover a little bit quicker. I encourage people to participate. In fact, I'm going to make you participate. So the theory, of course, you know, what you're going to see on the screen and the handouts is very important, but if you can't actually apply it, what you get out of today's session will be severely limited. Okay, so let's go for another real-life example. Give me another real-life example. Somebody here, when's your workout? When's your last meal? What are your goals? What's your body type? I'll show you how to use this. Who wants to be a guinea pig? You're going to learn more if you volunteer. Okay, Vincent. Tell me about one of your workouts.
I usually do a routine where I do pull-ups, and then I do long jumps, and then I do kettlebell swings.
Okay, so it's okay. What time of day would that be usually? In the morning, 10:30, 11 a.m. in the morning. When would you have breakfast?
You should have breakfast around 8 to 8:30.
8:30. Okay. So, are you usually hungry and have a complete, good, solid breakfast?
Yeah.
Okay. So, in this case, let's give an example of what his breakfast might be because he's happy at 8:30. He's got plenty of time to digest an awesome breakfast. What would we say, Vincent's body type? It's a little tougher with kids because they're going through these, you know, long, thin growth spurt when they may really be more mesomorph. So you kind of look at their parents as well. What would you say, Vincent, is if you had to guess? I have time when I'm mesomorph. Yeah, I would say probably mesomorph, maybe with a little bit of ecto in there, but probably more than mesomorph. So I agree. So we understand, let's turn to the mesomorph. Now, very important, parents here, okay? Another good way to manipulate this, to make it work for you in portion sizes, what the 2 palms of protein-dense food, make sure you understand, a palm, Vincent's palm is this size. His dad's palm is way bigger. So that's a very easy way to also analyze your portion sizes. So what would be, I want you guys to think, can I have another few volunteers to build, using some ideas here, food here, or just using it as inspiration, what Vincent's breakfast should be? What could be his 2 palm sizes of protein foods? And let's say the limit is you can't do a shake, we've already done it, so no supplements.
Eggs.
Perfect. Okay, so if you think about scrambling up some eggs, you probably, my guess would be about 3 eggs. So there's protein. Check. What's next on the list? What do we need?
Vegetables.
What vegetables do you like if you were going to make an omelet or an egg scramble or something?
Maybe celery, cucumbers.
Would you put that in some eggs? Okay, would you scramble it with the eggs? How would you do that? Okay, so he might scramble it with the eggs, he might chop it up on the side. He's got his 2 fistfuls of veggies. why would I prefer fruit and hash browns? More whole food. Okay? But again, this is where you kind of go with what your comfort is, you go with how ready to make the switch to the whole foods you are. Perfect. What else? What are we missing though? Fat. How much fat does he get?
2 thumbs.
Great, I'm on the end of that. Perfect. 2 thumbs of fat dense food. So what might we add? Or what could we have? Cheese. You might throw in, perfect. You might throw in two tablespoons worth of cheese into that omelet. Perfect meal. You guys get how this works? Okay, so that happened at 8:30. 11:30, 11 o'clock rolls around. He's got to go into his workout. He's feeling a little hungry. And what are his goals? Score performance. What's he going to have?
1,300.
How much? Very good question. Take a look at the very bottom of your sheet. What is a PNC drink? What's that mean? Okay, how much?
15.
Okay, so this is where you need to be able to read labels. Is everyone here comfortable with reading labels? You need to take a look at the scoop. So, and this will save you money here as well. If I look at a single scoop here, it's got, I think in this one, if I remember, it's 30 grams of carbohydrate, or 30 grams of protein, 35 grams of protein. So he doesn't quite need a full scoop. Okay? So it goes into his, everyone know what a shaker cup is? This is a shaker cup. It's got this thing inside that looks like a whisk. Okay, so he can have it right away. I'll pull it out with my fingers in a second so you can see what it is. And then he makes that into his shake. He takes that to his workout. He drinks it when? While he's working out. Okay, does he guzzle it right before?
No.
What does he do? Sips it through. Okay? How much water does he put in?
2 cups.
As much as you want, bare minimum might say a cup and a half. Okay, but think about the amount of fluid you could take in during your workout so that your tummy's not sloshing around, so that you stay hydrated. Here is a little mini whisk. Again, basically what it is, it's a little whisk, so you can shake it up and therefore you don't have chunks in your shape, and it's way better. You had a question?
Yeah, for the protein and carb shape, is the carb taking into account the carbs that are made of protein powder, or is that separate?
Very good question. I would say that no, because then it's going to get way more confusing. Typically, what you want to just make sure is that if you are buying protein powder, get what's called a protein powder isolate. Okay? Excellent question, because it's going to allow me to branch into some other things. Protein powder isolate basically means that there is mainly predominantly protein in there. There might be 1 to 2 or 3 grams of fat and maybe up to 5 grams of carbohydrate. So the carbohydrate amount in the actual serving is negligible. So if we're having half a scoop, there might be 2 grams of carbohydrate. So am I going to be worried that Vincent's taking in 32 grams of carbohydrate versus 30? No, because these are all based on averages. You know, nobody's absolutely perfect. Another very important question. It says 2 cups of juice or sports drink. Okay? What type of juice? If I put in apple juice, or say I want to go a few less supplements, if I put in apple or orange juice, what do I have to consider if those are my options? Well, sugars are what we want. Sugars are absolutely what you want. You need that fuel. Problem is fruit juice. Like, this is what we would tell if we're going to have people to drink juice. We want this 100% stuff. We don't want the fake juice, so to speak, in theory. Okay, this is going to get a little confusing. I hope I don't lose people here. But the sugars in fruit juice is fructose. Fructose is hard to digest. It has to go through your liver's processing system and then to your muscles. So during a workout, that could actually be a negative thing because you want those sugars very quickly. So if you are doing a strength training workout, lower intensity, where it's more about like just muscle strength. There's lots of time for recovery, and your sets are like 3 to 5 minutes, or sorry, your sets are about 5 seconds, 10 seconds, and you're not pushing your aerobic or anaerobic system. Fruit juice would be fine in a way to minimize your supplements. Okay, but if you're having an intense anaerobic workout, stop, start, breathing hard, that's where a Gatorade would be ideal, or something like this, which I'll talk about in a second. These are some other options. That would be ideal. Or, it's going to throw you totally for a loop here, going to the grocery store and buying the 40% fruit juice man-made mixture would actually be better. Does that make sense? Because you want a combination of sucrose and fructose, the slower acting sugars. Make sense? Hopefully it does. Always make sure you read the labels, because you're trying to figure out how much sugars do I actually want. So in this case, if I was going to do just a pure strength training workout and I wasn't worried about digestion capacity, a cup of apple juice has 30 grams of carbohydrate. So I have a cup there. A cup of fluid probably for our workout may not be enough, so you might want to water it in a little bit. Okay. Basically, what this is, these are some other options that you can find, would be instead of buying pre-liquefied carbohydrate, this is basically carbohydrate here, so you add it to water. So another option. What's good about this, advantages of this are that, well, this one comes with also some other wonderful natural additives that are supposed to help recovery. The other benefit is that you can actually very easily scoop out the amount of carbohydrate that you want, because it's based on the serving size, if you want to get into that sort of thing. Just showing different options, okay? So you guys know when you go into a supplement store and you see all this stuff, or you see what people are talking about, you kind of get it. Okay, do we want one more case study, or do you think you get it?
I have a question.
Yeah.
So during the workout, you have the 50 grams of protein, and you say we choose the option of the Powerade or Gatorade.
Yep.
You mix that in there?
Yes.
Okay, so you go, okay.
Yeah, so you mix the two together. You have to see, all the trainers at PI, they've got they do a scoop of this, and then they put in a full thing of, where's my typical? Typical calorie, like your typical sports drink, has 32 grams of sugar. Some of them a little bit more, so just read the labels so you know. Okay? So you throw that one out. Yeah.
So on a workout, like if I come here for a 9 o'clock workout,
yeah,
and ride a bike, takes about 40 minutes before, so about 8 o'clock.
Yeah.
What time would be best to eat, and what kind of things would,
what would you eat? What would you say your approximate, what I said, and thanks to Helen in there, what would be your approximate body type, would you say, already? What do you think you tend to be?
Between 11 walk and end of walk.
Okay, so partway between. What are your goals?
Just to get better health and better health and...
So where you want your tremendous weight loss. So we're done the weight loss, now we're on health maintenance.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's important to understand. So you're doing a 40-minute bike ride, high intensity, low intensity, what is it?
Medium to high.
Medium to high, okay, so 40 minutes plus an hour workout. So we're looking at an hour and 40 minutes work. So what he's probably going to do, and we're looking at body decomposition. That's going to be a tricky one. You are kind of falling in the middle. This is where it helps to have a little bit of perspective and a little bit of knowledge. And my feeling of what you would do, what are you having for breakfast? What's a typical breakfast for you right now?
I usually have a bowl of steel kettle and boiled egg and fruit with the oats.
Okay, what serving do you typically have?
A small bowl of, so I would put in a quarter cup of steel cut oats with a cup of water.
Yeah, okay, and how much fruit would you add to that?
Usually about a, well, probably a quarter cup of raspberries or blueberries or something.
Okay, so what would somebody, what would be somebody here, what would your guesstimate of the amount of carb-dense food Randy's having in his breakfast then? How many fistfuls of carb-dense food do you think he ends up with? Have to be able to, this is the one thing that you have to be able to start to estimate. I can give you my estimate, and anyone just throw out what they, their guess would be, and I can say, yeah, that sounds about right, yeah.
About 17
and a half grams. Okay, just say we're talking about cup or handfuls, keeping it simple. Based on Randy's description there, small bowl, steel cut oats with some fruit, do you think, is that one handful? Is that one and a half? Is that two? Is that three? Is that four? How much is that?
One and a half.
Yeah, I would say one and a half would probably be generous.
Oh, and I should have about 3 tablespoons of yogurt.
Of yogurt?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to say the 3 tablespoons of yogurt and a single egg. How many handfuls or how much protein dense food does he have there, would you say? Maybe I might even be a little bit more generous again, ballparking, because the 3 tablespoons of yogurt, is it Greek yogurt?
No.
Change it to Greek yogurt. If you change it to Greek yogurt, then we've got about a palm full of protein dense food, okay? And we've got about a palm and a half, let's say, of carb dense foods. So what are we missing from Randy's veggies? Okay, it's gonna be hard to wrap his head around that. Veggies we're missing. What else?
Fats.
We're missing good fats. Okay, so to improve Randy's breakfast, I would say increase your carb-dense food by, instead of a quarter cup of raspberries, maybe do you like bananas?
Yeah.
Half a banana in there, okay? And then maybe some more, take it to like a cup of berries or 3/4 of a cup. So we're getting closer to what he wants, okay? So I would do that, and then what type of nut butter do you like? Do you like peanut butter? Do you like
peanut butter?
You like peanut butter? Okay. So he's between a meso and an endo. So we're going to say put in 2 tablespoons of peanut butter. Do you see what I'm doing here? I'll just manipulate this a little bit. Can you see yourself eating some carrot sticks or some tomatoes, or do you have
any? Yeah.
Okay. So throw in, let's just start with a palm full, just to wrap your head around it, a palm full of veggies. Okay, have that. How long do you think you can have that before you write right?
Well, usually I've been having sugar so early in the morning, it's probably half an hour or 45 minutes before.
This is where the problem lies. If I have him do my suggestion half hour before he gets on the bike, and this is perfect because real life shows you the holes in this new nutrition approach. It sounds really awesome until you actually apply it in real life. There are a couple of scenarios like this where that's not. So, why is it not going to work? What this wonderful new breakfast that I gave Randy, if that's his schedule.
Too hard to digest.
Too hard to digest. He's not going to like me very much. He's going to have a crappy ride and a crappy workout. So, his options are get up earlier and eat the breakfast that I suggested, or stick with your original breakfast. You've got a couple of options here. Stick with your original breakfast, and what you could do is on your ride, have your 15 grams, maybe even 7 grams of protein. Okay, so 7 grams of protein powder, 7 to 8 grams of protein powder, and you can have your Gatorade. So there's our 30 grams of carbohydrates. During his workout, he could, option A, have another 7 grams of your protein powder and some fruit juice, depending on how intense your workouts are. I think usually they're more strength-based here. Or you could have a banana that you're nibbling on. Or you could have more Gatorade. See what I'm doing there? Okay? So again, you have to kind of play around with it a little bit. So we've upped his starchy carbohydrates a little bit. So it's not perfect. His other options could be, you could have your normal breakfast. You could have your, keeping it even simpler might be to have your protein powder, your 15 grams of protein powder, your Gatorade, space that out over your entire workout. Right after your workout, have a banana and some type of protein, whether it be another couple of boiled eggs, whether it be some Greek yogurt, something along those lines, maybe some more peanut butter.
What are those energy bars like?
They're okay. They're not great. And this is where we kind of have to manipulate a little bit. This is where, you know, maybe you can have something like a Lara bar post-workout. So this is, it's got some carbohydrates, it's got some protein, and it's all from natural things. So, you know, that might be something that you could do. Again, getting further away from this, you can see where the nutrition lies in terms of making sure you're really prepared, your schedule is perfect, and how it all fits in. Now, certain workouts, you might have to do a combination of the traditional approach, which is more kind of what I was kind of melding the two approaches for Randy. Did you guys see how I did that? And then other workouts where it fits in with your schedule, then you can do the new nutrition approach in its capacity.
Yeah, because what I was asking probably was when I started riding, I did, like, you know, I didn't feel as good in my workout as before.
Because you're probably hitting the wall, you don't have that glycogen. So even the most basic thing was to start off is to throw in your carbohydrate, your protein drink, and right away you'll start to feel better. That's a way to just improve it a little bit there and keep everything else kind of the same. Okay? If you aren't sure what to do with this information, even if you were to take the concept of the body type meals from this presentation and then decide whether or not you feel comfortable with the workout drinks, that's still going to really, really improve your nutrition a lot. Does that make sense? Vegetarians. I know there's at least one vegetarian in the room. Are there any? How many other people would like to? Yeah.
Oh.
Pardon me?
Gluten-free.
Oh, gluten-free. Well, there's no reason why you can't do this gluten-free.
Yeah, but, and also dairy-free. So, like, I don't know what they're protein.
So this one is, so we have got a couple of options. So there's no reason why you can't do, so this one is dairy-free. So it's pea, or you know, non-GMO pea, organic rice, organic hemp. Okay, so there's your protein powder there. Any of the Vega type products would be gluten and dairy free. I love Vega, I think their products are awesome. Only problem is they won't let us stock them here. Doesn't mean you can't go out and buy them elsewhere. Totally encourage you to do so. But we've talked to our supplement company and they actually have apparently a competing product, and they said basically what they did is they took a look at the label up here, which says that in one scoop of Vega, it's got 3 servings of greens, 6 grams of fiber, 1.5 grams of omega-3s, which are awesome, antioxidants, probiotics, protein. Basically, they looked at Vegas and said, we're going to do like 5 grams more of everything to make it a little bit better, but keep everything else the same. I don't know for sure. I'm going to look into it. I'm going to research it. If they're true to their word, we'll start stocking that here. So that's an option. Is it better than Vega? Not necessarily, but it would be as good, and it's a nice option. We can give it to you a little bit less expensive. What is this? Why would you want to use it? Why is it different than the protein powder? What this is where you kind of have a hybrid between the two, the two systems. In one scoop of Vega or something similar, there are 11 grams of carbohydrate and 15 grams of protein and a bunch of the other good stuff. So good stuff being omega-3s and vitamins, equivalent vitamins and minerals you get from 3 servings of vegetables plus all the fiber you would get from that. So that's in a single scoop here. So where could I use that? I could use that as a small snack to up my veggies. Okay, so again, this is, where does that fit onto my 3 meals? Where does that fit? Well, it doesn't really, it's not necessarily a meal, but you could use it in case you get hungry throughout the day using something like that. That's where something like that would fit into. Could you use it during a workout? You could, but I wouldn't go with a super high intensity workout. It would be somewhere along the lines of a like a strength training workout.
And also, what there's 4 million of it's protein and meat,
and probably more digestible if this fits all into what we're saying. So there's your options there. Yeah.
Can you mix those powders into hot fluids, like or soups or something like that, to get the?
Very good question. You can put it into almost boiling water, not quite. I wouldn't microwave it because it might denature the protein.
But you could stir it in afterwards.
Yes, you could. So we stir it in our hot oatmeal. Yeah. So what I do is I make our oatmeal and then I stir in protein powder into it to up the protein content. Very good question. What are some other general questions here?
So you can use that kind of
workout. You could, but like Christine was saying, there's a sport performance line, which means it's more digestible, meaning that they for actual workouts, you do it. I will use this just as a snack, like a really good high quality snack. If I don't have time, I will also sometimes, because right now I'm on my weight gain protocol, I'm not scared of the carbohydrates, so I'm using this as my morning shake, because I'm finding one of the things that I would highly encourage you guys to do kind of outside of the scope of this, but make sure omega-3s. Mostly, I know it seems like I'm talking about a lot of supplements, but if you were to take a look at what I eat in my typical day, it's very, very whole food based. It's tons of vegetables, tons of fresh fruit, good quality protein for both vegetarian and my family. Our family does eat animal products. I'm not saying you have to, but we kind of have a balance of that. We make sure we're getting a lot of good vegetarian protein sources as well. But the supplements that our family does have, protein powder, omega-3s. Okay, I really recommend fish oil or algae oils, an equivalent if you don't want to do a fish. Why? What are omega-3s? What's good about omega-3s? And this is where I want you to take a look at your meal maker cheat sheet. So what I've done is I've given you a meal maker cheat sheet if you're not sure of what things are our best foods, what foods are good quality protein sources, because the protein sources that they show on this handout are all animal-based. It's hard to show non-animal-based, so that shows you some non-animal-based protein sources. But the fats, if you take a look at the fats, there's three different types of fats, and I'll get to you in 1 second. Three different types of fats. When you're choosing your fats, to make sure you have a good balance of omega-3s, omega-6s, and saturated fats. Choose your fats throughout the day, or at least on different days from those three different columns. So when you take a look at where you get your fat sources, and everything's coming from animal fats, you're going to have an imbalance of your fats, basically. I'm going to keep this in layman's terms. And what I got to problem is this leads to high levels of inflammation in the body. So if you're trying to recover from an injury, whether it be chronic or whether it be acute, you're going to run into some problems. High levels of omega-6s relative to omega-3s also limits your abilities, your body's ability to harness fat as an energy source. Fat is not necessarily a bad thing. In fact, you can see how certain body types actually do really well when you eat more fat. But you want to make sure you're getting a good amount of omega-3s in your diet. So it's really hard to, in the North American diet, unless you're eating a lot of fish. The problem with eating a lot of fish, of course, there's all sorts of crap in our oceans these days, so you don't know what kind of mercury and all that other stuff you're getting. So eating a balance of some fish, not having fish at every single meal, and having some omega-3 supplements. To every one of my clients who I work with nutrition-wise, I suggest 3 grams of omega-3s a day. Okay, if you are, it doesn't have to be fish oil, it can be either a hybrid of like algae oil and some fish oil, or just pure algae oil, anything that has omega-3s. If you've sustained an acute injury, I'm going to speed through these, of course I have way more stuff. been a lot of research, unfortunately, on the type of nutrition you can apply when you're dealing with chronic injury. Having said that, I would say take some of this information, which is all about reducing inflammation, and apply that to a chronic injury status. So, a diet high in trans fats or omega-6 vegetable oils promote inflammation. Inflammation in a very short-term window is actually necessary, but too much of it or too long of it, which happens in a chronic injury, is not a good thing. So if you have sustained an acute injury, or I would say, in my opinion, a chronic injury, stay away from corn oil or anything, a label that says hydrogenated fat or partially hydrogenated fat. Stay away from canola oil, stay away from margarine, stay away from soy oil, stay away from shortening. All of those things promote inflammation. Omega-3 fats reduce inflammation. So where do you get omega-3 fats? Salmon, supplements, like fish oil supplements, algae supplements. Also, research has shown that increased nut and seed consumption and olive oil can mildly reduce inflammation. Not to the same extent as fish oil, but it can. So again, this is where you can see if you're following these meals, regardless of whether it's endo, mesro, or ecto, you're naturally going to be in a low inflammation state. Does that make sense to you? You're already kind of halfway there. Other things for acute injury you want to keep aware of. Again, if you're following this should be happening anyways. Reduce your intake of processed carbohydrates. Processed carbohydrates also promote inflammation. What is processed carbohydrate? Here, I'll test you, hold up some things. Is that processed carbohydrate?
No.
Good for you, keep eating that. Is this a processed carbohydrate?
Yes.
Yes, okay, minimize that type of stuff. Is this a slightly better processed carbohydrate than some other stuff you would get, like pure white bread? Maybe, but I would still say try to minimize that. Whole foods, processed or non-processed?
No.
Very minimally processed. So you guys kind of get where I'm coming from, right? Pastries, chips, all that stuff. Stay away from it as much as you can. Unprocessed carbohydrates should still be included in your diet in the prescribed portions relative to your body type to make sure you get adequate micronutrient and caloric intake. That's very important. And another slide, which I didn't have time to show you, one of the things is, especially in bodyweight conscious sports, you can fall into a pattern of increased acute injuries, stress fractures, little pulls here and there, because you're never taking enough calories. So you want to be very aware that if you're trying to lose weight for your particular sport, don't go too crazy, otherwise you could set yourself up for getting even more injuries. Vitamins and minerals. So again, I'll share these slides with you if I didn't already say this, because this stuff is really hard to remember. But these are some actual supplements that they found affect your ability to recover from acute injury. So vitamin E supplementation, if you're taking vitamin E supplementation for any other reason, I think sometimes they recommend it for some sort of skin issues, etc., that can actually slow healing. So that's the one that we want to stay away from, at least during this acute phase, okay, of healing. So when I'm talking about acute phase of healing from an injury, like 1 to 3 weeks is what we're talking about, these three things, vitamin A, vitamin C, and zinc, you may want to consider supplementing. Okay, on my handouts, it'll put all slides, which I'll share with you. You can actually see what amount you should consider supplementing with. If you want to stay away from supplements, here are some things, just food, that you can include in your diet a little bit more during your acute injury stage. Turmeric, you guys know, am I saying that right? I know what it is, I eat it all the time, a lovely Indian spice, delicious. You can add that to your curries, or some ranks, or whatever, just to spice that up. Some people even just, I've heard of athletes just making like a turmeric tea to reduce inflammation. Garlic and flavonoids containing foods.